except that you change it at a country ID. So there is one thing called country ID that will be included. So that's why it becomes a country specific corporate data model. So if you look at it, so it's based on the country and elements that you have. So if you look at it, there are HRIS elements, and what are the HRIS elements or foundation objects that usually have a country dependency? So I should explain this. There are three objects that have country dependency. What are they? Right, legal entity, location, and job classification. Location, the country specific, is nothing but the address. So it's a corporate address, it's a business address that your company has.
Sir. Professor?
Yes?
Yeah, I'm not getting that window, means success factor window. Yeah, okay, fine, sir, thanks.
No problem. So here in the corporate data model, we have the dependency in country. Obviously, the first thing that differentiates the object from between countries is a country ID. This country ID is nothing but your three-digit ISO country codes that we have that are coming from the PIC list, obviously. The PIC list, you remember, the standard PIC list has this country, and the country has a PIC list. These IDs are nothing but the ISO country codes. And as I said, there are three objects which are country dependent. So corporate address and job classification are still available in your country specific corporate data model in the XML part. So this one is nothing, okay, it's just like how we make changes to our regular corporate data model. So you make the changes whatever you wish. Yesterday we created the corporate address for Netherlands. So this is something that we did yesterday. If you look at it, so this is what we did. Okay, so this is what we did for some country yesterday. Similarly, for example, if you want me to do this same activity for, let's say, Korea. You see Korea here, Japan, Italy, and all these countries. Let's say I'm going to do this similar exercise for, let's say, Korea. Okay, so what I have to do is, remember, you need to just copy-paste your corporate address object. So this is the end of your HRIS element, corporate address. After that, job classification local is starting. Okay, so I copy paste it. So I go back to my objects, if you look at it. So I just copied this one. So I go to this HRIS element for Korea. And so this is the job classification for Korea. I'll just put it before that. So okay, we have something, and if you look at this one here, for Korea, we'll have a corporate address section coming up now. So the same fields, if you want, you can change the fields, it's just an address, so I'm not changing anything. The same thing should be okay for us. Okay,
so this question. Robin, I think I'm missing a little bit. So you are copying from another country, so if you explain the reason for that, I mean.
So I'm just copying because you need to have a source, right? You can copy from any country. There is no other reason. If you want to manually write the logic, you can write it. There is no separate reason why I'm copying. Why I'm just reducing the effort that we're putting there. Because at the end of the day, all the strings and everything are similar. Okay, only things on the right side will change. If your customer has a different thing, apart from this, copy accordingly, copy or create your own stuff. If you want to create, then you have to use all the custom strings or custom dates, whatever you have. And then place it. Okay.
So if you want to take, you wanted to make the field in the like the other country, the country you are source country you are copying from.
Yes, I just taken from Netherlands or the one that was before. I just want the same format of address to be available for Korea as well. Let's say just copied it. Okay. So I'm just reducing the effort of manually typing all the things if needed. I'm just copy pasting it. If you have a different field characteristics apart from string, then use some field characters like for example here, when you go to US, you've got all these custom fields available, okay? You can use all these things, custom strings or custom dates, custom longs, whatever you have. You can use anything as a reference and then copy paste there. Or if you want to write by yourself, you can also write by yourself. Or you can also go to the standard corporate, sorry, country specific corporate data model that you are SAP has provided, copy paste from there as well. Whatever it is, it's just that I'm taking so that I'm reducing the effort.
Praveen, to narrate here, see, in SuccessFactors itself will have own standard fields will be available for each and every country, number one. Mm-hmm. Number two is for certain countries that we, if you want to do some kind of a tweak or some changes, yes, we need to do our own logic and we can incorporate it out.
Right.
Second. Third thing is, the same Netherlands, if you want to copy, if the other two countries are there, same Netherlands address style should be there. So we can copy that Netherlands and just copy and paste to other countries. Number three,
right, you're,
number
you're
four,
right.
Whatever that we discussed yesterday on the address field, I mean universal address, we take on logic commonly, then attach that same to all the countries.
No. So when you have a same address for all the countries, irrespective of country, you have one address. I don't put it at a country level. Why would I put it at a country level? Instead, I put it in the object itself, the main object itself.
Oh, so main
country
itself.
Dependency, I'll put it in corporate data model so that I don't care about country at all.
Okay.
So right. Can I, you don't need to have the actual country specific corporate data model at all. If let's say 60 countries, you have 70 countries.
Yes.
If 70 yeah. countries and you have the same address format for 70, then you need to repeat this activity for a waste of time. Right, I'll make it standard in the corporate data model itself for location and use a standard format for everyone.
Okay, can I see that where exactly we do that the object?
So how do we make changes in the corporate data model? So like how we did the other day? So you have this corporate data model. So just put it in location, some fields, create it as address, all the use custom fields, all these custom strings are available for you. So just use them and put it as address and whatever format that you want. That should be okay. Okay, so we're back to a corporate data model. So now I'll just show you by going to Korea, because before we upload it, I would like to make sure that Korean does not have anything. Okay, it's got it uploaded, right? So I'll quickly go to creating a location, so which we renamed as personal area. So this is Korea. I don't see anything for Korea. Right now what we'll do is we'll upload this one. It's 5. So I go to provisioning. I'll just go to country specific. Corporate data model, choose an import file, it's 5. We're uploading this one. So now once we upload it, when we go to Korea, we should see the fields. So that's what we do in a corporate data, country specific corporate data model. So very simple, I mean, you just put fields, whatever you want to see when you have a country selected. That's all we do, so nothing else. Right, this is uploaded, so now let's say I go back and create a location again. And let's say I go to Korea. You see address coming up now. Previously it was not. So this is what we did just now. So just put the fields that needs to be populated when I select a country. Okay. All right. So this is how you make changes now, XML level. So for XML, in XML, you can only modify two objects. One is location and the other one is job classification. So you can put country dependent fields on these two objects through your data model. The other option that we have, since we have objects migrated to MDF, the country specific objects in MDF should be created as a child object and associated with parent object. Okay, so country specific objects, like for example legal entity has a local object, right? India has some fields, let's say Netherlands have some fields. So these values should be created as a child object, and we need to have a composite association with your parent object. And also the condition is, when you select the country, whatever it is, then it should populate these fields, otherwise it should not. So we put a condition in the object which says this should be available only when you select a country. That's what we're doing here. Okay, so in the migrated foundation objects, what we have to do is we have to create a child object. That means another foundation, another object. Literally, it's called a foundation object or a migrated foundation object or a country specific object, whatever you want to name them. At the end of the day, you create a custom object for a country, put the fields that you would like to see there, and then put a composite association and put a condition on country. That's the logic, how we deal with it. So for that, let's go to your configure object definitions. Configure object definitions. Should not write it, you should say it. Configure object definitions. So when you go within the configure object definitions, what we have is yesterday, I'll just show you what we did yesterday first, so that we can quickly create another one. So yesterday we created for Netherlands, if I'm not wrong. Legal entity for Netherlands. So this is the one that we created yesterday. So this was a custom object that I created yesterday called legal entity Netherlands. So this one I told you affected dating. Usually the child objects take the dating from the dates from your parent. You can't have a date for your child object separately and a date for your parent object separately. Right, the legal entity should not have a separate date than the fields that in for Netherlands has. That's not how it works. Usually if a child object is dependent on parent, then usually it inherits the effective dating functionality from your parent. It's not child legal entity. Don't call it child legal entity. Okay, it's object, child object. These are nothing but the fields for every country. When you have a country dependent legal entity fields, let's say when you create a legal entity, you want to have some fields populated based on the country. Like for example, for US, you would like to have a federal employer identification number or something else to be stored when you create a legal entity. So these are employer data. These are nothing but the company's data, something to deal with your registration numbers and all those things. So these data has to be stored based on the legal entity that you have. So legal entity will have a start date and end date and everything, but not the fields. So this field should not have any specific characteristics. So it should inherit everything from the parent. That's why all the child objects which has a composite association with the parent, composite is what? It displays in the same screen, right? The object itself will be embedded in the same screen. That's a composite association. So when you have a composite association, usually these objects will have the effective dating functionality coming from your parent. So you should always choose from parent. Okay? Usually not. You should delete the association that you created, otherwise it will obviously have to delete the association. Once you do that, it should be fine. Which one? I'm not at creating anything, I'll show you. I have not created anything, I'm just explaining field by field. Because anyway, we'll go to MDF objects separately. So we see how to create them. Since we have a mix of things now, that's why we have to see it now. Okay, So API visibility status is, you know, API visibility is for the interfaces. If at all things has to be modified through interfaces, then you need to put this as this one. And then MDF version history. Previously, as I said, corporate data model does not store any history of your changes. It will override with the latest one. But with MDF, whatever changes that you make will be logged. Okay, so you have better audit functionality here. Who are making changes to which object and all these things can be tracked. And then workflows are not needed, because if you want to create a workflow, when you change, let's say, when you create a legal entity, if you want to have a workflow, MDF supports it. So whoever creates a one MDF object, if you want to have a workflow, you can do that. But that's not something that we do for, because this is done by system administrator. Right, so I don't think there would be any workflows for this one, so which is fine. So then what we are doing here is, remember, all the MDF fields that you see here are all system generated. All system generated. We're not generating them. So only fields that I created yesterday were three. What are they? Registration number. And then type of registration. And local council of registration. Something, just a basic thing that we did. And then we associated this with the parent legal entity. So we have a legal entity object where we said this is association to legal entity Netherlands, one to one legal entity Netherlands, and it's a composite association. Within that there are some details that you have to remember. So here the condition value says Netherlands. That means whenever you select Netherlands, then only this should be available. Otherwise it won't be available. Okay, so you can have labels and everything that you want to have. So now let's create a new one for Korea. Okay, so we'll quickly create one for Korea, and then we'll put the associations and everything. So this is legal entity for Korea. So what should be the effective dating for Korea? What is the option for effective dating that we have here? Parent, right. So it should take from the parent. API visibility, you can put based on your requirements. And then complete history, label, legal entity, Korea. So all these things can be anything. So this is a change request. Employee change request. Yeah, of course you will have parent, non-basic, multiple changes per day. Basic is like one change per day. You'll have one change per day. It's like your time constraint in SAP. Multiple changes, only one, something like that. So usually basic is like one change per day. You can have one valid record per day. That's if at all this is a child object, it's always parent. If it's composite association, if it's independent, then you can have it based on whatever you have. Okay. For independent objects, yeah. So none is like, there is no effective dating. It's like one record. When you change it, you change it. Whereas basic is like one change per day, multiple changes per day. Name itself says what it is, right? So. All right, so we have legal entity Korea here. So I'll choose the labels as per requirements. So instead of this, let's say Korea employer registration number. Okay, I'm putting something for the second step, and then I'll also create one more field who could be type of form. So I'm just choosing something here, type of just some random thing, whatever came to my mind. Don't take it as okay, for courier user needed. No, it's not. I'm just putting some text so that we can see how it actually works. So that's it. I created objects. Sorry? You want to create one more? Registration date. Don't put spaces here. It won't accept. The registration date. I'll take a date format. Registration date. Okay, so you go to details if at all you want to put some characteristics. Okay, so I'll just save it. So created courier. Now, what should I do? So we need to go to the parent and associate it. So we go to the parent now. We don't change any fields in the legal entity unless you want to change separately. So this is two. Ali, or I'll put it as legal entity, Korea. So what is this one? 1-to-1? 2? Legal entity, Korea. Right? So composite association. So just take this field reference. So country of registration dot code. This is important, okay? Put the same thing, condition field ID. So when you go here, you can also put a label, remember, this is legal entity Korea. To the association, okay, I'm putting it to the association so that you see it there. So for registration code, so this is nothing but country of registration, that's an object dot code. So the field of country should match KOR. Value, conditional value. Okay, that's it. Now I save it. Before I save it, let's go quickly to manage data. Quickly to manage data where you create legal entities. Let's say I create the legal entity. You won't see our child objects here if you look at it. When a child object has a composite association, you cannot maintain data separately for them. Whereas when you have a valid when kind of a association like business unit separately, you will see them. Because they are also associated, right? But you don't, for example, you see them here. You see them. Because they are also child objects in your understanding. But remember, when you have a composite association and then a child object, the child object and composite associations never be maintained separately. It's always maintained with the parent. So now I go here. As of now, we did not save it. So Korea, KOR, you don't see anything, right? Nothing is coming here. So now I save this one, whatever we did. So I just cancel. I'll go back to legal entity. Then select Korea. Now you see the legal entity courier details, courier employer, registration number, municipality authority, type of form and the date, and you see a format for date. Right? That's how you create country specific legal entities or legal entity local object that you have. Since it's migrated to MDF, this is how we deal with it. Is that clear, everyone? Yeah, you can do that, right? You think you can't do that? Well, that's because of the object that I selected. I'll show you. So here, I have currency or description of a name, let's say for example, which one you want to take. So I'll take a new field for you, okay? I'm just creating a new field. What do you want to have? PIN code. Let's say I'll have PIN code. It's 5 digits. It's number. That's how I do it. Okay, so that's how we create country-specific objects in the corporate data model. So a quick rewind of what we learned till now. So we learned what are foundation objects, please. So we've seen all the different types of objects, why they're used for, how to create objects in all the different ways that we have, and how to modify country specifics in the foundation objects, what are all foundation objects which has country specifics, and we've seen how objects can be maintained both in MDF as well as in our data models. Okay, and also how we deal with the country-specific migrated foundation objects as well as the traditional country-specific foundation objects. So this is what we learned. So this is the back-end configuration. Whatever we have seen till now is a back-end configuration, right? So what we have to look at is a front-end. So this data should come to employee. When I say front-end, does not mean your UI. When I say the actual front-end is your employee data. Everything should be replicated to employee. That's why we create all these things. Otherwise, we don't need to create anything. If we don't use any of these things for employees, we don't need to create anything. But what you have to remember is whatever we created till now should be logically represented at an employee level. Let's say, for example, when I go to employee, when I hire an employee, I should hire for a legal entity, kind of a business unit that he works for, a division that he belongs to, a department that he works for, the cost center that we associate, and a location group, a zero zone, or a job classification that he has. All these details should be assigned to employee. Okay? So this data that we have should be replicated at an employee level. And which deals with employee data? So when I go to an employee, let's quickly go to an employee. So employee data is stored in different objects again in employee central, like similar to your info types in SAP. So these objects are maintained usually in your succession data model, and country dependencies for succession are stored in your country specific succession data model. Okay, so this is your personal information. So this is a screen where you see employee data. So if you remember, when we discussed about employee central in the first class, I discussed about this one. When you hire an employee, you take data of employees from employee, right? If you take certain data from employee, the data that we take from employee is mostly the personal information that does not change when you change a company, or usually, right? So this data is standard always, and we take the information from the employee about this data. So this data, we classify them as personal information, or the objects individually, they are called as person objects. They're named as person objects, and you have employment related information which we assign to an employee through the company. So that talks about the relationship the employee has with the organization. Like what is your legal entity that you work for, which job, which position, and whatever, all the objects, and what kind of salary that you draw. All these things are related based on your position, your relationship with the organization that you have. So this is assigned by us to employee. Whereas personal data is independent of us, independent of the organization. So that's why these are classified into two categories, personal data and employment data. Employment information, personal information, the objects you see here, each portlet is an object. This is national ID card, this is personal information, address, biographical information, work permit, contact, personal contacts, dependents, payment information, all these things are your personal information. These are all called personal objects. Each one of them is called personal objects. And you also have employment information. So this is nothing but your job information, job relationships, your compensation information. Right? So this is your employment object. The most important aspect of employment data is job information, remember. So you have job information, employment details, you've got your job relationships and compensation information. So these are the objects that are called employment objects. Personal objects, employment objects. End of the day, they're all part of the master data, employee's master data. And which deals with these data, which deals with these screens, is a succession data model. So succession data model talks about what you see at an employee level. Okay? The employee data that we see in the front end is coming from your succession data model. So let's say, for example, if I want to hide this field called last working date, because I don't want to see that, where do you do that? You have to go to your succession data model and modify it. So it's available in the front end itself now. So succession, you don't need an XML actually. There are two ways in which you maintain it. One is through XML, the other one is through UI itself. So I'll show you both the options of how you modify data from your employment and personal objects. But before that, if you would like to make a note of all the objects that you have, that's fine as well. I'll just explain them, what category they belong to and why they are used for. Okay, so we go to import export data model in succession management and provisioning. If you would like to export your succession data model, so this is import export data model, and then export the data model. Remember, this is an addition to your employee profile. A key note to everyone, keep this in mind, especially for those people who are working with customers, and especially those customers who have already implemented talent and would like to migrate to Employee Central with the core HR. This is very, very critical, and this is one of the most common mistakes everyone do. Everyone, almost everyone, 90% of the consultants. What happens is, when you start a project, usually you take the standard success factors data model and upload it. The moment you do it, overrides the existing, that's fine. But as I said, the customer has already implemented talent management. And remember, in talent management, we discussed about the succession data model as well, the employee profile. And there are some aspects of employee profile which we did not discuss. They are part of your talent management. The section you see are the background elements in the backend. The background elements or user info elements or succession settings, succession management. So if you look at this one here, so these are your background elements. So this is from your performance management, goal management, succession management. So what you have here is scorecard, positions, and your education background, so courses, certificates, awards, experience, all these details are needed in your talent management. And these are usually configured based on your talent requirements. That's something that performance guide does. And if you start importing a standard object, all these things are gone. The whole performance settings that you have, so they have very small settings, and you wipe it out. Whatever basic that they do, you wipe it out, and the problem starts there. The performance, whatever succession management settings you have is gone. So that's why it's very important. Only elements that we change are the HRIS elements. When you copy paste it, remember, you have to include these HRIS elements, that's it. You don't include anything else from your standard. And the standard elements here are also fine. You remember, in the standard elements in our employee profile, in a talent system, we saw only 40 fields. But now you see more fields here. There are around 143 fields. okay, so which are considered important in a succession, sorry, in an employee profile system. So this standard element section talks about all the fields available. We don't touch that. It's just for managing the labels, you can do that, but ideally don't touch it. From an employer central perspective, we should only deal with the HRIS elements. What we do is when we import, so let's say your customer is already using talent management and obviously they'll have a succession data model, which we have seen already, right? So what we need to make sure is we just take the HRIS elements piece, which is needed for our employee central, and then insert it. Or even in your employee central succession data model, make sure in all the background elements, other configuration that they have is copied from your talent, whatever, either this or that. Make sure the other elements that you are not using for employee central are mapping with your current configuration. Like background details, like for example, your education history or your certifications, all these are usually stored in your performance management. That's called talent profile. Okay, where you put all these things, last year ratings, all these values are usually there in a talent management system. So all these values, you should take the structure and put it here, so that you are not mixing both of them. When you upload a standard, what happens is it overwrites everything. No, don't do anything. You should have both the fields. You should use both the fields. So when you have a talent management system, you have only some limited fields, right? So the limited fields that you have should be same as what you have in your talent. Put them here in employee central also. And then add all the extras. Which one? The UDF file you're talking about, employee data. Yeah. That will also remain same. Even if you have an employee central system, if you remember, I said employee profile will remain the same. The UDF file is always the same. So in employee central, we deal with employees data import. Okay. So in the data import, the data migration activity, the first thing that we do is importing the UDF file. The basic, it's called basic import in employee central, but end of the day it's the same as your UDF file. That's the first thing that we do. Then we add our additional information like employment history, job history, compensation, personal information. All this data would be added in addition to the standard UDF file that you have with and without employee central. Okay, question? Don't mix both of them. They're two different things now. Okay? So your HRIS elements from corporate data model are called foundation objects. That's it. Here, these are different. These are different objects. Whatever streams that you have seen at employee data when I've shown you in the employee's profile, that's what is in your succession data model. They are called HRIS elements. Let's say, for example, you go to this one. The job information is HRIS element. Whereas there, company or legal entity is a HRIS element. Here it becomes a field. That's different. So there are two different things. We'll talk about how they work together. Okay? So in succession data model, whatever HRIS elements that we have here are all employee data fields or employee data portlets that you have. Okay? So let's try. I hope online you are able to hear me. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yes. Okay, no problem.
Yes, no problem.
Sure. So each and every element of HRIS elements is what we're going to go through now. We'll try to understand whether it is a person object or employment object. Okay, to start with, person information. So you see person info. Person info, it's a personal object, obviously. It's a person object. The person info is also called biographical information, usually. You see it as biographical information. So it talks about your employees, date of birth and all this data. Date of birth, birth name, date of death, which you never predict, but place of birth, all these things. Okay, so that's your biographical information. And then your personal information. So this is your actual personal information. It's also a person object. That's person info, this is personal info. Person info is your biographical information which deals with your date of birth. Whereas personal information is your first name, last name, middle name and all the stuff. So I'll show you the differences as well.
So I think we are working on the HRIS object for succession data model only for.
Right. So this is your personal information, which contains all these fields like first name, last name, display name, preferred name, gender. Whereas biographical information talks about person ID, this things, whatever. Birth name, place of birth, date of birth, date of retirement and all. Okay, so here, global information is usually part of your country specific, if you would like to, but this is also a person object. Home address, person object. Home address is nothing but your address, info type 6 in SAP. Personal information, info type 2. Personal info, info type 2. Phone number, email info, emergency contact, all of them are your person objects, obviously. The contact details, and it's your info type 105, if I'm not wrong, with subtypes like email, address, I mean, phone number and all. Okay, emergency contact, and then you have direct deposit, it's bank details, info type 9 for you. Remember, this direct deposit is a obsolete object now, to be honest. This is still used by some people, but all new customers, I would prefer not to use it. Why? Because there is an MDF object called payment info that's active now. So all the customers prefer using that object instead of this direct deposit object. So this direct deposit object is an old one to store your bank information details. The problem why we're not using this in this object is because it has some limited functionality. Okay, so it does not have date effectiveness, obviously, because it's a person object. So, and also it does not have functionality that your MDF can support, like validations for all the fields and everything is possible in MDF. So that's why they launched a portlet called Payment Info, which is the one that every new customer is trying to use now. Okay, remember, it's payment info. Direct deposit is obsolete, I would say. And then you have job info and direct deposit part of person objects again. It's your personal information. It's not something that company gives you. Then you have job information. It's obviously your employment object, and this is the most important object that you have for your job related things, because it stores a lot of information and everything is important here. The whole of employees association with the organization is defined in one single object, that's job info. It's employment object. Of course, yes. That's what I said. So employment and personal objects, both are together, employee data. It's nothing but employee data. Okay? So, guys, please don't chat because it disturbs me. I have to see whether it's a question or some personal chat.
Sure.
Sorry. So that's what it distracts. That's why I usually try to off the chat because people say hi, hello, and what are you doing? So it sometimes distracts what I'm doing. So the next thing that you have is the global assignment. And before we go to global assignment, to be honest, all your foundation data, all your foundation objects that you talk about are available as fields in the job information. All of them. Your position is an MDF object, but still it deals with your org structure. You have legal entities, locations, business units, business areas, all of them. Okay, everything, divisions, departments, everything is available in job information. That's where the whole bunch of employees' employment details are stored. And this employment, I mean, the relationship with the organization is stored. All the fields that you know till now, job grades, or job codes, pay grades, everything is available in your job information. Global assignment is also an employment object. You know what is a global assignment, I hope? It deals with employees' job. I mean, if you're transferring an employee from one country to a different country, we usually use the global assignment functionality. So that's also considered an employment object. Because remember, whatever screens that you see at an employee level are all here. Then you have work permit information. Work permit information is a person info. It's a person object. Because it deals with employees' documentation, passport details, visa, and all those things. And then you have comp info. That's nothing but your compensation.
Pravin, just a question on the global assignment. You know that in SAP there are lots of difficulties when you assign one employee from one country to another country to maintain the same employee number or making some changes. There are lots of difficulties and challenges. I worked on a couple of projects in global assignment. And how SuccessFactors deals with the
we'll talk about them in the global assignment class because we have a separate section for that. So however it works, we'll see there. To answer you, just to give you some information. So SuccessFactors, when you create a global assignment for an employee, creates two records. There would be two employee records for the same employee. Just one line answer at this point. It creates two records. Two different usernames and passwords.
Person ID will be the same, right?
The employee ID will be for the person ID, which is like a central person in SAP, which would be
same.
That's what I was about to tell you, sir.
Yeah.
So the person ID external, there is a field called person ID external, which would remain same, which is a unique reference for employee in the system. So that's the only thing that is common. And based on this, you track the employee, okay? Like SAP, how you have a central person, you have something called as person ID here, which will be same for an employee who is on global assignment. There would be two records. For both the records, person ID external would be same. Okay? That's like a central person in SAP. We'll talk about it in detail when we go to global assignments. Don't worry about it at this point.
Sure. Thank you.
Then you got comp info. That's nothing but your compensation information, which deals with your comp data, pay grade, pay range, comp ratios, range penetrations, and your total salary, whatever you have, all these things are part of compensation information section. And within that, you've got leave of absence, if you look at it. Sorry, not within that, sorry. Leave of absence is a separate thing. This is used for usually employees who are going on long-term absence or loss of pay or something like that. And you usually run an action of leave of absence so that the employee becomes inactive in the system. It's also an employment object. And you've got pay component recurring. So you have a pay component recurring there as well, if you remember in foundation. That's all, that's nothing but wage stripes. But the wage stripes should be stored here, right? There we have pay components, but here you have two things called pay component recurring and pay component non-recurring. These are like InfoType 8, 14, 15 for us. Okay, InfoType 8 stores usually the basic data, basic salary components. The, all the components that are put in the pay component recurring are usually part of your annual salary calculation. Whereas all the components that are put under non-recurring are like one-time payments, which are bonus, all these things. 14, 15 ideally. From SAP, if you're trying to map the wage stripes to this one, remember InfoType 8 wage stripes will go to your pay component recurring. Ideally remember, pay component recurring is your fixed components. Whereas non-recurring are your whatever one-time payments or special allowances, spot bonuses and all those things that you have. Then you have you can define a date on which it needs to be paid. No, you're talking about the what is that called? PP mod, right? PP mod? What is it called? Frequency, what is it called? I forgot payroll also.
PFREQ.
No, not PFREQ. Okay, PFREQ is used for your annual salary calculation usually. Yeah. I'm talking about 14 where you have a payment model defaulted. Yeah. Right, based on that you define the frequency. I don't think...
InfoType 8, you have a payment model, LGMST.
No, InfoType 8 defaults your wage type model actually.
Yeah, wage type model. That's not a payment model.
Payment model is usually used for InfoType 14 where you define a frequency which says, okay, pay alternative periods or pay every week or something like that, which is not InfoType 8. LGMST is used for a different purpose. It defaults the wage types that you have to see in InfoType 8. Whereas you are, let's not talk about SAP payroll here.
Yeah, as per my understanding, as a 14 will be the your recurring, you pay every month.
Right, you pay recurring.
InfoType 15 is non-recurring, it's a one-time payment.
I understand. But usually, even though 14 is a recurring payment, it's not part of your annual salary. So in SAP, that's how you deal it. But here, we don't have so many places where you maintain. You have only two places. One, pay component is recurring, pay component non-recurring. Remember, in even pay component non-recurring, you can put some wage types, which can run every period or whatever it is. The problem is if you put it in pay component recurring, it adds your annual salary, which we don't want to. Usually, basic is something that we prefer to have in pay component recurring as part of your success factors best practices.
Praveen, these two fields we are using for compensation or you are using mainly for compensation, right?
So this is, so this can be used for compensation as well as this can be used for payroll. Okay, so this is a place where you create all the wage types in SuccessFactors. You assign all the wage types to employee here in these two sections, which will be transferred to payroll. So even my current project, so I create all the wage types in SuccessFactors and send the data to payroll.
Okay, because how we deal is that whenever you create this, then you have to transfer immediately to the EC payroll.
Yep, that's how it works. It should be automatically done. When you assign an employee some wage type in pay component recurring section, it automatically modifies your annual salary and everything. So
can you do using this or you normally do in MDF, Praveen?
Sorry, what is...
You do using here now or you will be doing later on in MDF itself?
What do I do in MDF? I did not understand.
I mean, is that something is going to move out from here to MDF?
No. It's not going to move out to MDF. These are already available in the UI, but they're not MDF. It's called business configuration section, where we can actually see a similar replica of the screens. We can simply maintain there as well. I'll show you both the ways. As of now, here you know how to modify, right? But there are certain things which are new here, which I'll explain. Then you have employee status, and then you have payroll info. So these are new sections. To be honest, payroll info is used when you have payroll data. Frequency is part of your pay components itself, pay component recurring. Then you have bonus information, comp adjustment, citizenship info. So citizenship info is your person objects, all the above ones are employment objects. Work eligibility information, termination information, employment information. Termination information, employment information are your employment objects. Okay, job relationship is your employment object. I don't know, personal relationship, this is new again for me also. Okay, it's dependent, sorry.
Praveen, I have a question actually.
Yes, go ahead please.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, actually, like in org assignment, we can see the payroll area for the employee, right? So here, where we can see the payroll area?
So usually it should be in your comp information or your job information. So usually put it in comp information, you assign the pay group.
Okay.
So when you go to an employee, let's say for example, when I go to my employment information, there's a pay group. Actually, someone changed it to pay team here, but it's a pay group, North American pay group. So it's in your compensation information. Remember, we don't run payroll here, so it cannot be personal area also, to be honest. Sorry, payroll area. Okay, it can be one group of employees, let's say, for whom we run the payroll in SAP system. We group them together, send it to SAP, and they should have their own settings there to run salary or whatever accordingly. Because there you might take it based on salaried or employee street, employee group subgroups here, right? Here employee group, employee subgroup does not have much of importance like your SAP. Because SAP, whole of SAP runs on these two groupings, personal area groupings and employee group, subgroup groupings. But here employee group and subgroup does not have so much of importance, it's just a field.
Because you don't run the time evaluation, that's why mostly right. You don't need, and also you don't run payroll, so you don't need.
We can run time evaluation now, to be honest. We can create all the accruals and everything. We can also run some basic time evaluation with the timesheet solution.
Only for leave generation, but you cannot do the time interpretation.
You can using the timesheet. You can run a time evaluation in the timesheet level.
But even can you interpret?
As I said, yes, even then we don't.
No, as of now, it's not there actually. There is no time interpretation available. It's only the you can do the this thing. It's called the leave generation, quota generation, and accrual generation.
There is a timesheet functionality available in SuccessFactors, which can be used for time valuation based on your working times from your work schedules, but not your time coming from your punch outs, or login logouts. That's something that's not available.
You cannot.
Not available, but you have timesheet where you can run the time valuation. That's possible. So anyway, keeping that aside,
you are seeing only the earnings. What about the deductions? We will define the deductions.
Deductions is not handled here. There is a separate deductions management portlet which needs to be activated for a customer if at all you want to maintain the deductions in SuccessFactors.
Yeah, because certain each and every country have their own deductions. Right. General, like in India, we have PF deduction, we have VSIC, and right. PF.
We're not running payroll, so that's one of the reasons why we don't deal with deductions.
No, we need to attach that particular deductions element to employee.
Exactly. There is one section where we can define deductions management in employee data. That's a new thing where you can put deductions within your. So it's a portlet, end of the day. Remember, it's just a portlet which says deductions, and whatever you put there is a deduction.
But country-specific payroll objects are not here, isn't it, Praveen? In this, what you are training, the country-specific objects are not available.
We don't have it.
Yeah.
Okay, so other objects, national ID card information, and this is a payment info that I was talking about, which made your direct deposit obsolete. And the national ID card information is also country-specific, remember. So now, coming back, let me quickly show you the other one which is also available in the UI, and then we'll see modifying these things, okay? So for that, go to Admin Tools. Go to Admin Tools. So in the Admin Tools, go to Manage Business Configuration section. So you see the same objects here, and you also see employee profile where you see the standard fields, standard elements, and user info elements. So this is your standard elements and the user info elements. So this employee profile here. So you see all the fields like what you see here from your standard elements. These are all the fields that you see there. Okay? And forget about them. Don't modify anything. Don't change that. You have the object that we're talking about here. So it's very easy to use, unlike XML, to be honest with you guys. I don't use XML anymore for section and data model. I never go to XML because it's tricky and not so convenient for us. Let's say, for example, I've got home address. So this is my home address. If you look at it, so these are the fields that you have. And you can also activate it. The label is changed here, enabled, disabled. So for example, if I want to disable one complete object from here, it's very tricky, okay? But from here, you can simply say no, that's it. It's very easy to disable it. And similarly, changing field properties. Let's say instead of this one, I would like to say address 1. You can simply change the label, either field is enabled or not. That means nothing but used or not, then mandatory yes or no, and then you can also go to details where you can say, you can select a type of reference object, whether it's a PECless, employee, foundation object or something.
And then you can do it in instances, isn't it?
Sorry, yeah, this is in the instance
itself.
Right, so it's in the instance itself. Visibility masked, this is important. So here, this is the PECless. So say it's a PECless. Select the PECless. Same. Or you can also put the PECless ID here, the reference object. For example, if I select a foundation object, if this has to be location, I simply have to say location. You have to put the ID of foundation object here. Okay, so this is how you can modify here. So there are two ways as you see it. One is to manage business configuration in your admin tools. And the second one is through your XML. Okay, so we can make modifications just like how we make any other field changes. So this personal ID external, if you look at it, I can make some changes. So let's say I'll create a new field, or let's say I have custom long. Yeah, I can also go and assign custom string. Right, so if at all, let's say I want to create a custom string. What I'll do is I'll go here and I'll say custom string 1, okay, so this is custom string 1, I put this here and instead of saying age, let's say test string. Okay, English string. Okay, created this. So when I go here, I should see a new field here. Right, so I can save it. Now I go here. So when I go to employee, let's say, so where did I assign it? It's in the biographical information. We go to personal information. Just give me a second. So we are uploading this one. So when we go to personal information, so we should see one more field here after we upload, which says test string, right? So this has been uploaded. That's why I'll come back here. So what if I don't see that here? What could be the reason? Could be permissions, okay? Remember, if you can see it anyway, test string, right? Same way, I can go back to manage business configuration. Go back to manage business configuration. And improve. So it was in person info. In person info. You see custom string coming up now. I delete it. Instead, I'll put something like, let's say, custom double, test double. So this is enabled, yes. Required, no, obviously. So you can see all these things, okay? Whatever characteristics that you would like to put there. Is there any specific significance for the custom double? There's a date, time and type of the fields, right? So usually when you use a double, and it's a number, long one, right? So let's say I go to an employee again. I go to employees personal information. I don't know where this double data is coming from. Could be someone might have used it before or something, but still. Anyway, for us, forget about the right side. We'll see how data come there on the right side. But now you see the field coming up. Right, so you can do it in either XML or here, and people would prefer obviously doing it in the manage business configuration because it's quite easy. Right, so likewise you can change any other field, anything else actually. So you can change all the fields, and if you want to, let's say, deactivate one particular portlet, you can simply go to manage business configuration and disable it. Don't delete anything. You don't need to delete anything, you can simply disable it. Okay, make sense? How to make changes?
Maybe one question, Ritu here.
Yes, Ritu, go ahead.
Would you be able to send us the file, because we need to first export the file and then make changes and
import? Yeah, of course. I sent the corporate data model to the group. I'm not sure if they sent it to you or not, but Kanchan and all, someone should have it. So then,
yeah, we got it actually. Thank you. We got it. Yeah.
So someone can send it to the whole group.
I got to everyone. I just saw that in the morning. Yeah. I'll send.
So I'll also send this one in the country specific succession data model as well to the group, so you guys can have it.
Thank you.
Okay. So I can modify the here or in the business configuration so that it's easy. I would prefer doing it in business configuration because I don't like doing coding at all, so it's easy for me to do it in XML, sorry, in the business configuration section. So we won't have a class on Monday. We'll have a class on Tuesday, the same time though. Okay, so if you guys would like to have a couple of hour sessions, let me know. Okay to do that.
That would be good. And you want us to do any homework, Praveen? That would be
I'll send an email. Okay, good question. Actually, I forgot to tell this, but so the point is, I'll be sending you an assignment to start with. So you get an workbooks, the project workbook kind of a thing, which has the foundation objects as well as the employee data, where you need to modify all the orange fields. Okay, whatever fields that you have, so you need to modify them accordingly in the XML. Forget about the legal entity and all these XML and these things because they are not needed anymore. So change anything else or just try to go through it and see how we actually make changes at a customer level. Okay, so I'll send you this assignment today so that please forward it to the group if someone receives it. Okay, or I'll also send it to you. I can also ask them to send it to you. So this is something that you guys can complete by Tuesday. Okay, it's a good assignment, so do that. Keep your XML separately. I'll see them and then we'll discuss about that for half an hour on Tuesday. Okay?
See you.
Thanks, Kanchan, for reminding. Actually, I was thinking about this one, but I missed it somehow. So thank you.
If you send, I can forward to everyone.
Sure, I'll do that.
If you have the group email ID, you can send to everyone.
Yeah, you can send me the email IDs. Maybe I can, that's better. So that I can send it to the whole group usually.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, and then everyone.
One request to all while doing an assignment, just to maintain the naming conversion, because if I use my own, then I will use my naming conversions and other,
Please, but remember one thing, don't end up doing anything to the system, okay? Just keep them separate, because we're all using the same system. I use the same system for customers as well. So please make sure you don't, I should say,